Welcome to A Look Ahead. We're delighted that you've decided to join us. You probably know by now that we study the Sabbath School lessons as prepared by the Seventh-day Adventist Church, and this particular series is entitled Biblical Missionaries. Now, what group of people would those be? Well, we're going to find out. This is a series of lessons for July, August, and September of 2015, and this is the second lesson in that series for July 11 of 2015, entitled Abraham, the First Missionary. So before we jump into Abraham's story, I'd like to suggest that we bow our heads together and let's ask to God to guide us as we think about this experience of Abraham. Our wonderful Father, we know that you were really the first missionary, but you worked through us, you worked through Abraham, and now we need to see what Abraham did, how he stepped out in faith, why he stepped out in faith, what were the results, what can we learn, how can we be, can we follow the good points in Abraham's experience and not the bad points, and we ask that you will guide us in that discussion today as our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Let's be clear right up front that God's original plan was
for us to never descend.
For all of us to be living in pure peace and happiness without sin in the Garden of Eden, right?
Yeah.
But it fell apart when Adam and Eve sinned. Before long, it was necessary for God to send a flood to wipe out the human race except for one family. We've suggested in previous sessions that God had to do that to preserve even one family that was listening to him. And not all of them were saints. Or to rescue the human race in the form of Noah and his family, as we've suggested. He started over with Noah, but once again, what do we find? It wasn't very long until they were at the Tower of Babel and God had to divide up their languages so they couldn't talk to each other. In our study for this week, God was starting over again, this time with Abraham. Why do you think Abraham, in those days he really was called Abram, came to become the spiritual root for the three major monotheistic religions of the world, Judaism, Christianity, and Islam? Why do we always seem to sort of go back to Abraham?
Well, that's where they came from. That's where they split off from.
Okay. Yeah.
Abraham made some mistakes.
It's very interesting to read what God said to Abraham back at the beginning. Genesis 12, 1 to 3. The Lord said to Abram, "Leave your country, your relatives, and your father's home, and go to a land that I'm going to show you. I will give you many descendants, and they will become a great nation. I will bless you and make your name famous so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, but I will curse those who curse you, and through you I will bless all the nations." What was God's original plan with Abraham?
Going to evangelize the world.
The good news is going to spread to the whole world, right? Did it work out that way?
Wait, do you think it's finished?
Sure it did.
You think it's finished, though?
What?
You just said, did it work out that way?
Well, I mean, has it worked out? Maybe you want me to say, has it worked out that way so far?
No, not so far.
Okay.
But
well, it depends to what level you.
Mm-hmm.
Christianity is known the world over pretty well.
And there's an interesting statement. Well, go ahead.
And all of that all came through Abraham.
There's an interesting statement that talks about that. Now, there's a famous verse I should mention first, and we probably should go back and look at that. A lot of people turn to this verse. Look at, I can get my little doodaddies here to work. Look at Genesis 15, verse 6. A lot of people turn to this verse and they think this is really the real answer to our problem. Abraham put his trust in the Lord, and because of this, the Lord was pleased with him and accepted him. What does that mean?
15:6.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead, read it from a different version.
RSV says, "And he believed the Lord, and he reckoned it to him as righteousness."
Mm-hmm.
Well, another way you could say is he believed God and that was the right thing for him to do.
Yeah. Well, look what happens according to James in the New Testament, James 2:23. "And the scripture came true," So now he's going to tell us how this worked out. That said, Abraham believed God, and because of his faith, God accepted him as righteous. Now, that's what you read to us, right? Mm-hmm. And so Abraham was called God's friend. So what's going to be the result if we have the Abraham experience?
We'll be called God's friend. Just as Jesus said back in John 15:15.
Yeah.
No longer call you slaves, but I call you friends. Mm-hmm. Because of everything I learned from my Father, I have made known unto you. What he's doing is teaching about his Father.
Okay. So now, here's the challenge. Think about this. Abraham had no Bible, no pastor, no church. He lived amidst a group of idolaters. Even his own family were idolaters. We would probably call them pagans. How did he come out of that? How did he survive that?
He came out of that with some baggage. he was infected with some of the pagan ideas, but he was still listened to God.
Mm-hmm. He had origins from his ancestors there someplace.
Of course. Mm-hmm.
There was a truth there someplace. He just wasn't totally.
Well, what do we know about Abraham? Let's just, again, just taking the big picture. What was the result? What has Abraham's family done for us as a world?
Abraham was the father of many nations, and it's not just the Jews. It's you got the Midianites and a bunch of cousins fighting each other now.
But let's talk about the good things. What have we gotten from the Jews, from the Hebrews? Well, the scriptures.
Scriptures as they were, yeah.
Yeah, we've got the scriptures from them, basically. Okay, that's one important thing. What else have we got from them? Jesus came among them. Jesus was a Jew.
He came among them, but his heritage, his lineage was from several nations, even Moab, which was not a favored.
But name. primarily Hebrew, Jewish. They were supposed to be God's faithful servants and a light to all the world around them. That's what they were supposed to do. So in that context, if that's God's overall goals, why do you think he called Abraham and he said the first thing you have to do is leave home?
Well, my interpretation of that would be was that home was corrupt.
Okay. And so get out of it.
Right.
Get away.
Mm-hmm. And when you follow the generations, you follow, for example, eventually Jacob, for example, a couple of generations later, ends up heading right back down there to those people. And then when you read about him with Rachel and so forth, here she's got these idols that she's
hiding
and carrying. So
now, Abraham came from a clan from up north. Mm-hmm. Weren't they more God-worshipping than everybody else?
Well, I mean, that's hard to know.
No, it says somewhere, somebody says it, Ellen White said something about that.
Well, there's a couple things, and we don't have time to discuss these. If you want to read some interesting material, look up on the internet the city of Urfa, U-R-F-A, in Turkey. And you'll discover it, let me not take more time, but anyway, there's very good evidence from the Bible, from Ellen White and so forth, that the Ur and down in the southern Iraq that we have traditionally believed to be Abraham's hometown is not the right place. He almost certainly came from southeastern Turkey, a place that is now called Urfa or Sanli Urfa. And then, because it's fairly close to Haran, depending how you want to pronounce that. And I won't go into all the arguments why that's true. But for some reason, God says, get out of there. Leave that place.
Isn't that a good exercise, though, for faith?
Yeah.
Well, he could have had a good family. It could have been a good place. But if you believe God, mm-hmm. wouldn't it be a good exercise just to leave that place and then have faith in God to do that?
That's precisely what we want to discuss. How did Abraham develop that kind of relationship and have that kind of faith. And how did God speak to him? You know, was he whispering in his ear? Was he speaking through thunder and lightning? I mean, how did God talk to Abraham sufficiently so that Abraham, I mean, we don't think that Abraham was demon-possessed. He wasn't just on some kind of a lark. He wasn't in some kind of...
Didn't seem to have scriptures like we have.
Schizophrenic kind of deal. He believed that God was talking to him, and he set off.
It seems to me like he's almost an earlier version of Job.
Mm-hmm.
There are those that seem to have a more religious bent, even in our day and age, yeah. And I think that goes back in those times.
Hebrews 11, verses 8 to 10, talk about that very much. It was faith that made Abraham obey when God called him to go out to a country which God had promised to give him. So what does that say? Who called?
God.
What did Abraham do?
Pulled up stakes and went.
He obeyed. He left his own country without knowing where he was going.
Did he have the concept that he was to be a missionary? Did Abraham have this concept?
Did he know what a missionary was? Were there other missionaries?
Or was he just going out and going to...
I think the rest of our lesson will answer that question, but I don't want to spill the beans yet. By faith, he lived as a foreigner in the country that God had promised him. He lived in tents, as did Isaac and Jacob, who received the same promise from God. For Abraham was waiting for the city which God has designed and built, the city with permanent foundations, and of course that wasn't any tent city.
And where did he get that information?
Well, that's the question. Where did he get that information? No Bible, no pastor, no church.
It could actually be the writer, too, trying to explain what he was thinking when he was leaving.
What you're asking here is how, you know, what method of revelation did God communicate with Abraham, and we don't really know that where there's some other places you know, angels actually show up and talk with Abraham and do some things, but
well, here's why. Thank you for bringing that up. You raised my question exactly. You see, because a lot of people believe that faith is a leap in the dark. So is Abraham making one giant leap in the dark?
No.
Or is faith a relationship with God based on a significant amount of evidence? Maybe not compelling evidence, but a significant amount of evidence that you have put together over a period of time. That's the question. Did Abraham have sufficient reason to believe that the voice that was talking to him was not some kind of psychiatric problem? That it was God.
Well, I think Abraham fit that, but I nevertheless think that there are other people who leap out in certain types of faith that don't have. It's much more spontaneous and much more sudden impulse, but nevertheless, not God. It doesn't mean that God isn't communicating.
Well, the reason I'm raising this, and it's really important in my opinion, there's going to be Jesus appear one day on this earth claiming to be the Son of God, etc., etc., and Revelation 13, it says the whole world is going to wander after him. In fact, it says it several times. But some people are not going to wander after him, and those people are described in Revelation 14. What's the difference?
Well, I think people that don't suffer for that delusion are going to have a more intimate understanding of
That's what exactly
God is
the
like.
Point. How do you get that kind of intimate understanding? Now, we shouldn't even have a question about it. We've got the Bible, we've got all these writings, we've got it in multiple translations. I mean, we are the most privileged generation that's ever lived on this earth.
You know, Paul talks about people who have never heard the name of Jesus and are going to be saved. Are we saying that whoever those people might be, and there are probably some over in some remote place, are we saying, well, when the time comes, they're going to get left out of this because they don't have all of this stuff. They just have information and all of this.
They may be going to heaven, and God can save them. No, I don't have any problem about that whatsoever. What they won't be is a part of the group who stands firm and tall and witnesses to the whole world of the final truths of the gospel. They're just not prepared to do that.
So if Gary isn't prepared to do that, doesn't mean he may not get in.
Doesn't.
See, there's hope for you, Gary.
A lot of people have a problem with this, with your point there. This is not a question of salvation. This is a question of having a group of people that will present the final message. We're talking about missionaries here, okay? A people who will present the final message of salvation to an entire world.
This is a crack bunch of troops.
That's right.
When you watch the news now, today, there's a whole lot of stories out there and a whole lot of stuff that's passed out, but you have to decide what's real and what isn't, and what's truth and what is not just propaganda from one point of view or another.
Yeah.
And so how do you reach that point to where you can decide what's truth and what isn't? You have to have a background of what truth is, and that's the people that's going to be out there.
Right. And the way we find that background is Scripture.
Right.
Yeah. We need to get to know God so well that no counterfeit can deceive us.
I think Scripture is a very powerful tool or food source or whatever, but I think it's...
And more than one.
I think there's a relationship, there's a friendship,
that's the purpose of Scripture, so that we can become friends of God. That's what we just read about Abraham. That's what we're studying here.
But there will be, this will be predicated mostly upon experience, I think.
Well, experience with what? Experience with God.
Well, that's true, but the interpersonal relationship.
Yeah. Okay. Now let's. We haven't got to the end of Abraham's story yet, but let's just jump over for a moment. One night, Abraham heard a voice in the middle of the night. He said, "Take your son, and go to Mount Moriah, which is going to take you 3 days to walk there, and sacrifice him." Now, if someone in your family woke you up and said, "I just had that kind of vision. I think I'm going to take my son or my daughter out. I'm going to sacrifice them." What would you do today?
Call the police.
Call the police or take them to the hospital, right?
Right.
Well, now that's a confession of one's relationship. One is admitting one's lack of confidence in one's relationship with God.
But okay, and that's exactly what we're talking about.
I mean,
here.
If I say then I'm saying, well, I evidently don't believe my relationship with God is strong enough to help me figure that out.
Well, you know, and we every so often you read in the news, somebody, you know, it turns out that someone wakes up in the middle of the night and decides it's his job to kill all his family with a baseball bat. It happens. Other people kill him with knives and so forth. People believe that it's their job to go and shoot. I mean, our friends in the Middle East now are killing anybody who's not their particular shade of Islam because they believe God has called them to do that. How do you respond to that?
Well, that's different than Abraham's situation.
Well, why? That's my question. What's
well, I think Abraham's situation. I think Abraham's situation was another Job situation.
Okay.
I think just as God came down and using Job as a particular witness in a particular time, I think that was what was happening to Abraham as well. I think he was because it was a similar situation. Out of character here.
Yeah. James 2 tells us that when God called Abraham, the result was Abraham became God's friend. What does it take to become a friend of God?
Because he had a friendship with him, did Abraham suspect God would tell him to do something different at the end with his son?
Well, okay, let me take your question and twist it just a little
bit. Abraham wasn't the friend until he and Isaac went up on the mountain.
No, I didn't say that. I'm just saying that I think that that was the ultimate test of his friendship. That the friendship grew over time. Abraham came to the place, and I would say, when Abraham heard that voice, as scary as it was, what the words were, he knew that it was God's voice. He knew God well enough, there wasn't any question in his mind that this was a message from God.
And just as Job didn't understand why he was facing the things he was facing, Abraham may not have understood why he was facing the things he was facing. But now it's a little different in that the devil came down and interfered in Job's life. But
does God help people in our day?
Yes.
Does that mean all of us are going to have to pick up roots and go to another part of the world?
Depends on what
they
the call
get a
is.
Ticket. Go take a flight.
I think we have to have the test first.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Does God expect us all to just leave our homes and our families and our businesses and our jobs, etc., and say, go? Or what does this call mean?
Well, depends on what the call is.
Yeah. That's what I'm asking you.
Well, the test.
Asking of us and mm-hmm. saying, I trust that whatever you ask me to do, I will be able to do it and you will be there with me.
Okay.
Sometimes I wonder if I don't get calls all the time and I choose to pick the easy one.
Okay. What do you think Abraham said to his friends and his people he knew and his family that he left behind?
When he left?
Yeah, when he left.
I think he probably told
I had this
them.
Crazy vision in the middle of the night. No, what did he say?
They probably
had deduced already what kind of a man he was. I don't think it was a case of him and wife and kids just hopping on a donkey and heading for the southwest kind of thing. He was already probably a notable man mm-hmm. and probably had an entourage.
He was kind of like a city. Mm-hmm. I mean, it wasn't just like you and me leaving our house going somewhere. When he left, there were slaves, there was livestock, there was all kinds of stuff. There was probably a caravan that went for a couple miles, type of thing. So,
he certainly had to make some explanations.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But I think that two things. I think number one that he probably had the people recognized a certain integrity in him. So when he explained these things, they were willing to give him the benefit of the doubt. But, you know, I must have gotten this from Ellen White, that, Terah was his father? Yeah. Terah wasn't supposed to stop in Haran.
He died there.
Well, yeah, but after he stayed there a while. Terah, it was never intended that Terah was supposed to stay there either. Terah was supposed to keep moving as well. Terah was on a journey someplace as well, if I understand that correctly. So when Abraham said, I'm going to go ahead and move here, I've got to move, there must have been some who remembered, we were supposed to keep on moving, but we stayed anyway, so.
Maybe the question I should have asked is, what did his family and friends who stayed behind say about him after he left?
Wonder.
You'll never know.
Yeah. How certain do you think Abraham was about his call? Ellen White.
Certain enough.
Ellen White says this in Patriarchs and Prophets, page 126, paragraph 4. Many are still tested as was Abraham. They do not hear the voice of God speaking directly from the heavens. Does that imply that's what happened to Abraham? But he calls them by the teachings of his word and the events of his providence. So apparently that's the way he calls people today.
Well, the teachings of the word, that's one thing. Events of the providence, that's hard to divine.
Yeah.
Most of the time.
Mm-hmm. Well, I've said before, let me say it again, we are the most privileged people that have ever lived in this world's history. We have more light available to us. It's more readily available. I've got, I think, over 4,000 books in this tiny little computer here. commentaries and Bibles and languages and so forth. What are we doing with all that light? Ellen White comments, interestingly enough, in her book Life Sketches, talking about what happened to her. Had you followed the light which he has given you, talking about one of her friends, then he would cause more light to shine upon you. But while you neglect the counsels, warnings, and reproofs that have been given, how can you expect God to give you more light and blessings to neglect and despise? God is not as man, he will not be trifled with.
Okay, we talk about all this information that we have, and as Adventists we have this tomb of information from Ellen White. How much of that stuff are we supposed to read?
If God wrote you a letter, would you want to read half of it, 75% of it?
Well, I know, but I mean, it would take a long time to read all of it. We've got Signs of the Times articles, we've got review articles, we've got the testimonies, we've got the Conflict of the Ages series, we've got counsels to parents and teachers, and we've got counsels to this and that and so on and so forth.
Well, your life is starting now and you have the rest of eternity.
Well,
you know, though, we have all this information available to us, but Satan's not sitting on the sidelines.
No.
He's got just as much information, just as much resources to guide us in other directions.
Absolutely.
So our temptations are it's all relevant.
He's got gazillion authors out there writing all kinds of stuff and putting stuff on the news and anything to distract us from reading what God wants us to read.
But sometimes I think we're given this guilt trip that we have to, and then after you've read it all, what do you read it all? How do you have time to read all of that?
And then after that,
and then you've got Biblical Archaeological Review, which got some stuff, and you got the review, and you got our Modern Signs of the Times, and we've got our devotional books that come out all of the time, and children's books. I'm not. I'm just saying how much of that are we supposed to
stuff you have
supposed
to
read?
I see. My 4,000 books that I haven't read. Well, one of the things that happened to Abraham in the course of his life is,
before you go on, another thought to just before that. Talking about how do you know, talking about providence, God's providence. You know, I think what happens is we have a little light and we follow that light and we're rewarded for that light. And more light develops and often providence will develop.
That's what I just read from the quotation from Ellen White.
Well, anyway. I was thinking it before you read that.
Okay.
So that more opens up, not just information, but people, events, circumstances, money, whatever it is. Oh, but there's never enough of it. Mm-hmm. It's always just a dribble. Mm-hmm. But anyway,
You think all the information we have is just a dribble?
Well, but the information you have, you read it and then you receive enlightenment.
Yeah.
And
Let's take an example from the story. We're talking about Abraham here. All of a sudden the word arrives that there's been a war down in the valley. He's up on the highlands, and there was a war down there in the Jordan Valley, and his nephew and his family, all his family, have been taken prisoners. What does Abraham do? He grabs some of his friends, they organize themselves a quick army, and they go after these raiders. And what happened? Abraham organized them in the middle of the night, they attacked the enemy, completely wiped out the enemies, recovered all the stuff that had got stolen, including his nephew and crew. Is that part of what we should be doing?
Did he ask God if that's what he was supposed to do? Is that why he was sent
out
to be a missionary?
I'm sure he did.
You know, he brought back part of most of Sodom and Gomorrah back, too.
Yeah.
You know, when you read that story, and it illuminates it, you get the impression that there were people with his group that were pretty well trained, mm-hmm. and they knew how to handle yeah. swords and spears and whatever they...
We're going to talk about that in a moment.
Whatever they needed.
Well, the worshiper of Jehovah, talking about Abraham now, had not only rendered a great service to the country, but had proved himself a man of valor. It was seen that righteousness is not cowardice, and that Abraham's religion made him courageous in maintaining the right and defending the oppressed. His heroic act gave him a widespread influence among the surrounding tribes. On his return, the king of Sodom came out with his retinue to honor the conqueror. He bade him take the goods, begging only that the prisoner should be restored. That was the usual practice in those days. By the usage of war, the spoils belonged to the conquerors. But Abraham had undertaken this expedition with no purpose of gain, and he refused to take advantage of the unfortunate, only stipulating that his confederates should receive the portion to which they were entitled. Patriarchs and Prophets, page 135. So, what do we learn about Abraham now?
Well, he didn't want to be known that he got rich off this yeah. this experience.
Yeah, exactly.
I was reading here in yeah. Genesis 14.
Can you think of a few times in Abraham's life when he was not faithful to God?
When he lied about Sarah?
Twice.
Twice?
Genesis 12, 11 to 13, he lied about Sarah down in Egypt. In Genesis 16, 1 to 4, he lied about Sarah. No, I mean, Genesis 16, 1 to 4 is the problem with Hagar. And then Genesis 20, verse 2, he lied about Sarah when they were down in Gerar. Try to imagine the conversations between Abraham and God after those experiences.
What were you thinking?
Well, it happened twice.
Yeah.
So they had conversations the first time, and it mm-hmm. must not have done any good because he just did it again.
Slow learner.
You know, it's kind of like when you read it in the scriptures, though, it seems like the scripture's not really getting down on him for doing that. It's mm-hmm. just the way he thought that things needed to be done because of the situation.
Well, God wasn't giving him an heir, so take a secondary wife. And I can tell you that that was exactly what was expected according to the territory he came from. That was the way things were handled.
Well, but I don't know. In the promise, you know, aren't we supposed to take our faith and go forward with it, expecting to have, as I mentioned before, more enlightenment. Maybe Abraham just came to the conclusion, you know, maybe I'm supposed to be doing something here that I'm not. I'm supposed to exercise my faith or take some action or do something here, because it obviously isn't being fulfilled.
Yeah.
So,
does faith mean wait until God works it out, or faith means let me charge ahead and see if I can help God work it out?
What about what about the story of Loma Linda, where Ellen White had to write and tell, you know, I mean, the General Conference said, you know, don't do this, and Ellen had to write Burden and say, look, you go get the $5,000 however you can, and you put it down on that piece of property. Mm-hmm. You get this information and you feel like you ought to do something with it, but you don't have any more enlightenment. You just wait around. Or do you step out
well,
in
Abraham
faith?
Abraham waited for 25 years after he got to Canaan, and God says, well. He keeps coming and saying, you know, you're going to have a lot of kids, a lot of descendants. And Abraham says, yeah, and now Sarah's not having periods anymore, and I'm getting older. Maybe God needs some help.
And, you know, after Sarah died, mm-hmm. Abraham married.
And had six more kids.
You know,
six
so
more
there's,
sons.
Yeah, had
maybe
lots
daughters.
Of, lots of kids through there.
Mm-hmm.
So
when God finally says, okay, I'm going to come back again in 6 months and Sarah's going to have a son, Abraham left. First God says it's going to happen. Abraham left. A little while later, God comes back and says, 6 months from, I mean, 9 months from now, Sarah's going to have a son. Sarah's hiding in the tent. She wants to hear what's going on, but she's not, she can't be seen. And she's laughing. And God says, why did you laugh? And she says, oh, no, I didn't laugh. and she ended up in the chapter on faith. What's going on there?
Maybe the relationship wasn't quite as secure as we thought it was.
You mean God might work with people who aren't perfect?
Mm.
What a thought.
Oh, that was an awful big cataclysm to come out of that lack of faith.
Well, for those who want to know about how this aeration all worked out, probably the best place to read about it is the book Patriarchs and Prophets, page 154 and 155, because God said what Abraham did, especially in the Mount Moriah thing, was actually a witness to the entire universe. Well, it's a well-known sociological phenomenon that when people move to a new environment, they are much more likely to take up new habits, to learn new customs, etc. Traveling, especially traveling to a different culture, language group, or continent, is a very educational experience. It forces one to think about why she or he does what she or he does. Why do you think God asks the children of Israel, at least the males, to travel quite frequently from their homes all the way to Jerusalem, where there would be people coming from all over the world to worship there at Jerusalem, and they might get exposed to all kinds of other people? I think that was intentional.
You know, one of the things Abraham did that was a byproduct of his witnessing was to build those altars everywhere he went.
Mm-hmm.
And he was offering sacrifices on there, I guess. Why?
Let's talk about that.
Why are there such crude things?
Okay.
Why couldn't we have something pretty?
Well, okay, now you're asking for some kind of miracle.
Carve it out like they had, you know, later on.
It's been estimated that in Abraham's wanderings in his lifetime, he came across at least 15 different cultural and geographical areas.
I heard a Bible teacher mention that, you know, we think he just kind of traveled around a little place, but Bible teacher says he got clear on up into Russia is what he said, which
no.
I don't see how that could be.
He went from southwestern Turkey to Egypt and back to the Promised Land, back to Canaan. And what do we learn? Let's just look at some things really quick. Like, one of the first places he came to was a place called Morah and near Shechem. And God told Abraham, okay, this is the land I'm giving you. And there he built an altar, as you already mentioned, and worshiped God. Number two, at Hebron, further on in his journey, Genesis 13, 18 through 14, 20, God protected him and guided him as he went to war. He did not selfishly come home with the spoils from that war to enrich himself. He even paid tithes to Melchizedek. Another lesson. Three, at Mamre, Genesis 18:1 and 20-33, Abraham not only welcomed Jesus Christ and two angels who appeared as wandering travelers, but also received the promise of God, from God, that even at the age of 99, he was to have a son with Sarah. Later, he walked with Jesus Christ out to the edge of the Jordan Valley, overlooking Sodom, and bargained with God regarding that city. What do we learn from that? And then at Mount Moriah, of course, the story when he followed exactly God's instructions. 3 days praying every night, walking every day, to the point where he took the knife in hand to sacrifice his son. And God says, okay, that's enough.
The bargaining with Sodom, did he really realize who he was? Who was there and he was chatting with? Or did he just think it was an angel?
No, at that time he knew. He didn't at the beginning.
So this intimates a very strong, very personal relationship. Somebody who can sit down and talk about some things.
Yeah. So guess what that says about us and our relationship? Can we have that kind of relationship with God?
I don't know till he shows up.
Well, I don't think we have to wait. It says something very interesting in Genesis 18, 18, and 19. Look at that. I'll start with verse 17 because it puts it in context. The Lord said to himself, this is Lord with small caps, which means the Hebrew is Yahweh, God, the personal name for God. I will not hide from Abraham what I'm going to do. His descendants will become a great and mighty nation, and through him I will bless all the nations. That's a repeat of what he said back in chapter 12. I have chosen him in order that he may command his sons and his descendants to obey me and to do what is right and just. If they do, I will do everything for him that I have promised. He's going to command his children and his descendants after him. Abraham's house, this is Ellen White's comment about that. Abraham's household comprised more than 1,000 souls. Gary, you talked about the retinue that followed him. Those who were led by his teaching to worship the one God. Where did these people come from?
Some came from some he collected along the way.
He was being a missionary all everywhere he went. So those who were led by his teaching to worship the one God found a home in his encampment. And here, as in a school, they received such instruction as would prepare them to be the representatives of the true faith. Thus, a great responsibility rested upon him. He was training heads of families, and his methods of government would be carried out in the households over which they should preside. Patriarchs and Prophets, page 141, paragraph 1. Then God called Abraham to be a teacher of his word. Does that make it a little clearer? He chose him to be the father of a great nation because he saw that Abraham would instruct his children in his household in the principles of God's law. And that which gave power to Abraham's teaching was the influence of his own life. His great household consisted of more than 1,000 souls, many of them heads of families, and not a few, but newly converted from heathenism. Where did he get these people? Newly converted from heathenism. Such a household required a firm hand at the helm. No weak vacillating methods would suffice. Of Abraham, God said, I know him, that he will command his children and his household after him. Genesis 18, 19, which we just read. Yet his authority was exercised with such wisdom and tenderness that hearts were won. The testimony of the divine watcher is, they shall keep the way of the Lord to do justice and judgment. Genesis 18, verse 19. And Abraham's influence extended beyond his own household. Wherever he pitched his tent, he set up beside it the altar for sacrifice and worship. When the tent was removed, the altar remained. Jay? And many a roving Canaanite whose knowledge of God had been gained from the life of Abraham, his servant, tarried at that altar to offer sacrifice to Jehovah. Education, page 187, paragraph 2. So what was happening what was the result from those altars that Abraham was leaving here and there all over the place?
They became icons, talismans.
Centers of worship.
Churches everywhere.
Yeah.
Left his mark.
So, in light of that experience, we have been told repeatedly that a well-ordered Christian family is a greater witness for the truth than any pastor's sermon. Whoa, hold on here now. We're going to get ourselves into trouble here. We want to see the family altar established. Okay, we're thinking about altars that Abraham built, and we want there to bring our children right before God with earnest prayer, just as a minister labors for his congregation when he's before them. Every father should feel that he is placed as the head of his household to offer up a sacrifice of thanksgiving to God and a praise to him, and to present these children to God and seek his blessing to rest upon them and never rest until he knows that they are accepted of God, until he knows that they are children of the Most High. Wow.
How does that fit with the modern gender issues that we...
Yeah. Here is a work for the mother. What a responsibility rests upon her. Do we consider and realize that the greatest influence to recommend Christianity to our world is a well-ordered and well-disciplined Christian family? The world sees that they believe God's word.
Well, some of those eighth graders that we mentioned last time, pretty hard to well-order them.
Yeah. Well, missionary activities clearly are more successful when they're backed up by a family life that is in harmony with God's design. As we know, early in the history of Christianity, almost all of the so-called churches were located in private homes. And why was that?
There were no churches.
There were no churches, and why were there no churches?
Well, they were persecuted.
It was against the law to be a Christian. Yeah. What would be the advantages or disadvantages of having a church meet in a private home?
Advantages would be more intimate.
Yeah. Yeah. Get to know them better.
Any disadvantages?
Not big enough.
You would have to keep your house clean.
Yeah.
Well, and I quote, "It was faith that made Abraham able to become a father." That's Hebrews 11:11. It was faith that made Isaac promise blessings for the future to Jacob and Esau, even though he was being deceived. Right?
It was faith that made Abraham a...
I'm quoting the Bible. Why are you questioning?
I wonder if you're misquoting.
No.
Inappropriately emphasizing.
Okay.
Well, and what I asked the question, what sense did faith make it possible for Abraham to become a father? Remember that after Sarah died, he had 6 more sons with Keturah. That require faith?
Just a new wife.
Oh, I see. In contrast to Abraham's story, there are in the Bible some very sad examples of faithful servants of God who did not command their households after them. Can you think of any?
Yes. Eli.
Eli.
Samuel.
And Samuel. Yeah, they didn't command their sons. I mean, their sons were abusing their privileges as priests. Well, it seems that Abraham was called to be a light to everyone around him. And I quote again, now this is Patriarchs and Prophets 368, paragraph 2. God called Abraham and prospered and honored him, and the patriarch's fidelity was a light to the people in all the countries of his sojourn. Abraham did not shut himself away from the people around him. Last time we talked about salt and light. So Abraham became salt, right? He didn't shut himself away from people. He maintained friendly relations with the kings and the surrounding nations, by some of whom he was treated with great respect, and his integrity and unselfishness, his valor and benevolence were representing the character of God. So, how can we become like Abraham? Correctly representing the character of God? In Mesopotamia, in Canaan, in Egypt, and even to the inhabitants of Sodom, the God of heaven was revealed to his representatives. Well, okay, I'm gonna challenge you now. Pretend for a moment that you're God. And you've just been through the Abraham experience. Do you think God considered that to be a success?
Probably all he had right at that time. Yeah. All anybody was listening.
Well, the thing with God is that he knows the future, he knows the past, mm-hmm. he knows what's going on right
no
now.
No risks, right?
No, it's just that how can you, as a human, take a little chunk of time and then judge that as a success or not? When all this has implications in the future, mm-hmm. and it has implications of what happened in the past.
You know, one of the things that is a quality of somebody who has experience, mm-hmm. is when they encounter the unanticipated, they know how to, maybe because of experience, mm-hmm. they know that this is to be anticipated, and so you have some solutions. Mm-hmm. I think that's the way God is, and sometimes he puts Abraham in charge of some things, mm-hmm. and he knows that if there are some messes made, he knows how to fix them up.
Mm-hmm. How different would the Bible be if the story of Abraham was taken out? Gary asked that question, basically. Does God intend for us to learn something from Abraham's mistakes as well as his successes?
Sure.
Would he have preferred that Abraham not made the mistakes?
Does and Abraham seem a little more human because he made some mistakes?
And if he... Well, yeah, but we talk about, from time to time, about how things would be so much better if, for example, Abraham, things would be a whole lot better if he hadn't messed this thing up with Hagar.
Yeah.
So.
Well, who delayed that date? It was God. I suppose the answer is you might give all sorts of reasons why Sarah couldn't have a baby, but for sure when she finally did, who was responsible? God.
It was to show that God had miraculous.
This is
powers.
Why we laughed a few minutes ago about Abraham having children at this point in time. It was a miracle, on Sarah's part for sure. Well,
it sure was a... I can kind of sympathize with Abraham wondering what... You get to get this great big promise and nothing is showing up.
Mm-hmm. But the whole story is about teaching a faith to the whole universe.
Yeah.
And without those questions and mistakes that were made along the way, you couldn't have the full experience of what that is.
Mm-hmm. So, I think we discussed this last thing. So, I'm supposed to, according to Peter, do what I can to hasten the coming of the Lord.
Yes.
All right. And Ellen White did that, and James White, and Joseph Bates, and so here we still are.
170 years later.
So... I don't know, I can't go out and have a baby or with another, what I can't, trying to find a comparison here.
Yeah.
Did Abraham give up his faith in a way? And is that a lesson for me to, you know, be careful I don't give up my faith in a certain way? Or am I supposed to wait? And though those people waited, did they see something? Did Joseph Bates actually see the fulfillment of his patience in his faith? Did Ellen White actually, did James White actually see? Was there, you know, Abraham got to see something later after he'd made a big mess out of some things. Did those people, do you always, if you wait patiently, do you always get at least to see a little something?
Hopefully. But look what happens in our world. Let's be very blunt. How many of us are sitting in the pew waiting for the pastor to do the work? Now, he should do the work because he gets paid, right? Or we're waiting, we're not going to go out and do any missionary work because we haven't got a call from the General Conference yet.
Giving up on the pastors.
Well, maybe that would be a good thing. Then the rest of us would have to get to work, right?
I hope our viewing audience realize I sometimes take the devil's advocate here, not necessarily my convictions.
Really?
Okay. We're all called to be missionaries in different ways.
That's
and
right.
It may not be obvious that that we're doing pastor's work or something. Mm-hmm. Well, you're doing what you're called to do, so you can't judge people that way.
Well, you just mentioned some Ellen White's comments about people who are ministering in their homes and making well-ordered households and those kinds of things, and how much that more important that is than a pastor.
Well, Ellen White says these words in Christ's Obsolescence, page 326, paragraph 4. Not more surely is the place prepared for us in the heavenly mansions than is a special place designed on earth where we are to work for God. God has a plan for every single one of us. Well, are we daily and weekly developing a clearer and clearer understanding of the gospel so we can share it with others? To what kind of mission do you think God is calling you today? British explorer Sir Francis Drake sailed from England in December of 1577 with 6 ships and 164 sailors. His mission? To become the first Englishman to circumnavigate the globe. 3 years later, just 1 ship, crewed by 59 surviving sailors, limped into Plymouth Harbor. While ultimately successful in their mission, Sir Francis and his men had endured a litany of horrors, storms, shipwrecks, attacks by hostile forces, and starvation. In light of his terrible journey, the words of a prayer traditionally attributed to Sir Francis seem especially poignant. And I like this prayer. Listen to it. Disturb us, Lord, when we are too well pleased with ourselves, when our dreams have come true because we have dreamed too little, when we arrived safely because we sailed too close to the shore. Mm-hmm. Is that what a lot of us are doing? Mm-hmm. Are we too timid to reach out to others? Are we sailing too close to the shore? Do we have any questions in our minds about God's long-term goals for humanity? Are there things we need to leave behind before we reach out? Our fears, our material possessions, our sins, our comfortable Christian cocoon societies? Well, it's clear that Abraham was not always a perfect saint. As we follow along through his experience, we notice that he did all kinds of things. But a more precise translation of Abraham's story in Genesis 12:8 says he was a preacher in the name of Jehovah. Could we be like that in our lives, in our day-by-day experiences? Obviously, Abraham didn't spend all his time preaching. Sometimes he was a soldier. What can we do? What can you do? Our kind and loving Father, we thank you for being with us in our time together, in our discussion together. May we come to be more like you through learning from experiences such as those of Abraham, is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.